They say life is so much sweeter through the telephoto lens of fame. Around here you get just as much attention cheering at the high school football game. I dreamed of going to Nashville, put my money down and place my bet. But I just got the first buck of the season. I made the front page of the Turner Town Gazette. Every last one, round one, rural heart's got a story.
Despite its small size, Streator, Illinois has always been filled with people with big dreams. These dreams first began to develop at Streator Township High School in 1872. Its students were, and still are, strong believers in hard work and dedication. So with this strong, positive attitude, it is no surprise that Streator has been home to many successful people throughout its years. It is no secret that high school is a very important part in developing any person's character and discovering their potential. But what does Streator Township High School offer these graduates that made them so successful? Streator is a small prairie town located 81 miles southwest of Chicago. It is made up of about 14,000 people. Due to its smaller size, Streator has been able to work with the community to help all of its students develop their full potential. It has always been very easy for students to get one-on-one help from the staff at Streator, so all of his students have had full access to all of the tools necessary to succeed. Streator has undoubtedly been very successful in all that it has done, whether it be sports, dance, band, or scholastics. Streator has come very far. Just this year, the men's varsity basketball team took home its first regional championship since 1969. Also, the cheer and dance teams at Streator are no strangers to state competitions. With all these accomplishments, it is no wonder that so many of Streator's graduates have gone on to do such wonderful things. Now, let's take a closer look at each of the graduates' lives. Clarence E. Mulford was born on February 3, 1883, in Streator, Illinois. He attended Streator Township High School and graduated with a class of 1901. After graduating high school, Mulford went on to become a well-known author of the Hopalong Cassidy novels, which he wrote in 1904. The collection of novels consisted of 28 different books. Many of these books then went on to broadcast on the radio, made into a movie or a television show, and some were even revised into a comic book version. After leading a memorable and accomplished life, Mulford passed away on May 10, 1956 in Portland, Maine, due to complications and a surgery. Edward Plum was born in Streator on June 6, 1907. He was the grandson of Ralph Plum, the founder of Streator. He was best known for his work at Disney, where he was a composer. This love of music started in high school. He attended Streator Township High School, where he graduated in 1925. While in high school, he was president of the High Y Club, vice president of the Spanish Club, and editor-in-chief of the Hardscrabble. He was also part of the review staff and the Latin Club. The sports he participated in were basketball, the first ever track team, golf, and tennis. He got his start in composing when he joined the school orchestra. As a senior, Ed composed a class song for 1925, while Melvin Dawson wrote the words. After graduating from Streator, Ed Plum attended Dartmouth College until 1929. Following his time at Dartmouth, he studied music and harmony in Vienna, Austria, under the Guggenheim grant by Huntley Spaulding, a Dartmouth benefactor. In the 30s, Plum spent time in New York. Because the Depression was going on, Plum had to work odd jobs to support himself. This included being a professional boxer for some time. Even though he had a tough time supporting himself at first, he chose to stay in New York since it was the center of music for the nation. His first accomplishment was as a freelance agent for Paul Whiteman, Vincent Lopez, and Rudy Valley. In 1936, Plum's works became noticed by Walt Disney. He was asked to join the Disney Corporation. He was employed as a music director at Disney for 22 years until his death in 1958. While at Disney, he worked with Skolkowski for composing Fantasia. He is still best known for his work in creating the score for Bambi, where he was nominated for an Oscar. He was also nominated for three other Oscars for Victory Through the Air Power, Solidus Amigos, and The Three Caballeros. Other works included Tom and Jerry, Make My Music, Song of the South, So Dear to My Heart, Peter Pan, Davy Crockett, and Lady and the Tramp. Aside from Disney, he also worked for Paramount, Republic, and 20th Century Fox. He married Louise Masson of New York and later had three children before his death on April 18th. 1958, at age 51. Streator graduate Carl Soderstrom was a member of the Illinois House of Representatives. Soderstrom was born on December 14, 1915. Before his life started, it was the marriage of his two parents, Reuben G. Soderstrom and G.N. Shaw, that began his life. His father, Reuben, was a former state legislator from Streator and served as president for the American Federation of Labor, and then the AFL CIO from 1930 to 1970. His childhood began in Streator and ended when he graduated from Streator Township High School in 1931. After graduating from high school, he furthered his education at University of Illinois, where he was involved with the marching band. He graduated from University of Illinois in 1937 with a bachelor's degree. His education did not end there. He then attended University of Illinois Law School and graduated in 1943, and then admitted to the Illinois Bar March of the same year. Before fulfilling a degree in law, he married Virginia Mariner of Streator. Throughout their marriage, Carl and Virginia had five children who were all born and raised in Streator. Virginia put in her efforts of improving Streator's education by teaching German and world history at the high school for many years. Soldiersham worked in the Seneca shipyards during the time of World War II, where landing ship tanks were built. He worked in the steel procurement department, ensuring a constant supply of steel was necessary to keep the ship line in constant production for the 1,000 people who worked there. After the war, he opened his general practice law office in Streator, specializing in workers' compensation cases. In 1950, Soderstrom was elected to the Illinois State Legislature and was always proud of his strong endorsements from laborers, farmers, and educators from the area. During his time in the legislature, he sponsored numerous pieces from the House of Education Committee. He retired from this position in 1974. He held success throughout his career. In 1964, due to reappointment, Illinois held a statewide election, and he was a leading Republican with the most votes of any downstate candidate, tallying over 1 million votes. More recently, Soderstrom was invited from the House Speaker Michael Madigan to return to Springfield to address the Illinois House of Representatives, and also was invited by the AFL-CIO to the opening ceremony in Peoria to lead the 50th anniversary of the merger of American Federation of Labor and the Congress of Industrial Organizations. Soderstrom passed away on January 13, 2009. His life was honored by the Fighting Illini Marching Band, who played songs in honor after his funeral. May his legacy in helping the state of Illinois live on and inspire newcomers to fill his shoes.
One Streator graduate liked to show his sweeter side. Co-founder of the Baskin-Robbins Empire, Burton Baskin. He was born in Streator on December 17, 1913, to his parents Mr. and Mrs. Harold Baskin. His father was a Russian Jew that immigrated in 1905 and owned Baskin's clothing store in Streator, where Bert worked as a teen. Baskin's childhood home was located near the present-day Streeterland Historical Society in the 300 block of South Vermilion Street. He graduated from Streator High School in 1931, after 4 years of being an active student and avid athlete. He participated in Thespians Club and the band, as well as serving as the president of the Meteorological Club, vice president of his junior class, and business manager of the Hardscrabble staff. Perhaps this was an early indication of his future success. Butch Baskin, as he was known to Streator athletes, played football, basketball, ran track, and served as captain of the swim team. After graduating, he attended University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. He was a member of the Jewish Zeta Beta Tau fraternity and graduated in 1935. Later, he and his family moved to Juliet, Illinois, where his brother Al owned and operated Albert Baskin Clothing. Burt moved on to Chicago, owning his own clothing store in the Palmer House Hotel. In 1942, he married Shirley Robbins, the sister of Baskin's future business partner, Irvin Robbins. He and Shirley had two children. Their daughter, Eddie, went on to become a photographer for Saturday Night Live in the 1970s and 80s, while their son, Richard, was a film composer, producer, and director. He directed music videos for artists such as Barbara Streisand, Rod Stewart, and Elton John. Burt served in the Navy in World War II as a lieutenant. He was stationed in present-day Van 02. He acquired an ice cream freezer from an aircraft carrier supply officer and experimented with creating flavors from exotic tropical fruit on the island. His ice cream was popular among the troops. He was discharged in 1946 and moved to California with his wife Shirley. The same year, he opened Burton's Ice Cream Shop in Pasadena. A year later, he collaborated with his brother-in-law, Irvin Robbins, to open their first store together. Their first franchise, sold in Glendale, opened in 1949 with 21 flavors. They later sold the famous 31 flavors, one for each day of the month. Baskin continued to be active, as in high school, throughout his later life. He was a member of the International Franchising Association, the Board of Directors of Manufacturers Bank, the Tournament of Roses Committee, and the El Calibro Country Club. He was a charter member of the Honor Ledge of the Jewish Community Service Organization, B'nai B'rith, and his service to the community was recognized by the establishment of Burton Baskin Memorial Heart Research Fund at the Department of Cardiology of Cedars of Lebanon Hospital, now Cedars-Sinai Medical Center in Los Angeles, California. Burton Baskin died of a heart attack at age 54 in Studio City, California on Christmas Eve, 1967. He always dreamed of having a Baskin-Robbins franchise in his hometown. It wasn't until after his death that one opened in Westgate Plaza. Shirley Baskin came in from California for the opening event. Unfortunately, the store failed, leaving behind little of Burt's dreams and legacy in his hometown. Jim McMullen attended Streator High School and graduated in 1961. During his 4 years at Streator, he was active in many athletics and clubs, such as football, basketball, track, baseball, student council, Y Club, Hub Council, Spanish Club, and S Club. Once graduating from high school, Jim continued on to Northern Illinois University. Soon after, he joined the Marines for 6 years during the Vietnam War. During his service, Jim was wounded 3 times and was awarded the Purple Heart. After his 6 year stint with the Marines, Jim and his wife moved to Naples, Florida in 1980. It was here that this naturalist and author began devoting all of his time to the tracking of the endangered panthers in the Everglades. Jim has devoted years of hard work and effort to better understand the panthers. In efforts of helping this species out of endangerment, Jim raised his own panther named Tracker through a breeding program from cub to adult to further this intense research. Jim is known as a very prestigious author, tracker, naturalist, wildlife, lecturer, and consultant around the United States. His work with tracking and researching this species is all shown in his New York Times best-selling book, Cry of the Panther, Quest of a Species. Over Jim's years of tracking the endangered panthers in the Everglades, he came across another great experience. Jim has experienced unexplained encounters with the physical evidence and unaccountable strange sightings of the unknown creature named Bigfoot. It was in 1997 while tracking panthers that Jim came across this giant in person. Jim decided to go public with this experience and decided to start a new program for the unknown Bigfoot. Along with this endangered panthers program, he started a new program based on the preservation of an unknown Bigfoot species. Jim had hopes of releasing his new book that featured the history of the Everglades Bigfoot and experiences in 1999. Jim is a very well-known naturalist in Florida Everglades. He and his work have appeared in more than 100 newspapers and magazines featured stories nationwide.
We bring in our guy, Browns analyst Doug Deacon. Doug, always good to talk to you.
Nice talking to you guys, especially after a win.
That's right. At any point, though, in that game, did you contemplate jumping out of the booth because you couldn't take it anymore?
Actually, I was looking for that halftime tavern you advertised.
Doug Deacon attended Streator High School and graduated in 1967. Doug was an active member of athletics and clubs all throughout his high school career, such as Key Club, S Club, football, and basketball. He is most known for his 2-year activity on the varsity football team as a tight end. Doug was honored as an all-conference and all-state player his senior year after catching 54 passes total that season. After high school, Doug continued on to the University of Illinois on an athletic scholarship. During his college career, he was a starting end for 3 years and ranked second in Illinois grid history for career pass receptions with 89 total. After his senior year in college, Doug went on to play for the Cleveland Browns. He was drafted in the 6th round of the 1971 draft. His game in a Browns uniform was the exhibition game against the Chicago Bears. This game was the game used as a backdrop for the movie Brian's Song. After improving tremendously his first professional year, Doug was moved to left tackle. He became the third left tackle to ever play in the history of the Browns. Doug proved to be excellent at both run and pass blocking throughout his years, and eventually earned his spot in the Pro Bowl.
Adams, tight on third and one, looking for Greg Crook, and he was picked up by the Cowboys. He's going deep to Newsom. Ozzie Newsom, away from Cliff Harris, touchdown.
Doug played 14 seasons in the National Football League with 203 consecutive games and 194 straight starts. Through his time with Cleveland, he not only proved himself as a great football player, but also a fine citizen. During his 1982 season, Doug earned the NFL Man of the Year Award after adding his name and efforts to a number of charities. After his retirement from the football team, he still serves as a color commenter on Browns radio broadcasts, as well as appearing on WKYC in Cleveland. Combining his days on the field with his broadcast experience, he has drawn a paycheck from the Browns for a total of 35 years. In 2006, Doug was introduced into the prestigious Cleveland Browns Legends for his all services to the team.
Dr. Daniel J. Nagel is a man with a past of going as far back as washing dishes at Oogie's, an old root beer stand that was ran by his parents. After graduating from Streator High School in 1967, the man is among the top doctors in Chicago. Today, Nagel is a well-known hand surgeon that has operated on patients ranging from players off the Chicago Bears and Cubs to a man whose hands are blown off during a time of war. Nagel was referred to as Oogie throughout his earlier years till he graduated from Streator High School. His life started by being born in Ottawa, then living in Marseilles, Grand Ridge, and then to Streator. What brought Nagel into the medical field was from a dear friend of his named Dr. William Schiffbauer. Schiffbauer was a neighbor of Nagel's and also served as a family practitioner in Streator. Nagel claims he did everything from delivering babies to hip surgeries. Schiffbauer would take Nagel along with him to help him with house calls around the community. The medical field eventually lingered in Nagel. After helping out Schiffbauer, Nagel found his calling. That calling would eventually one day bring Nagel and a man from Armenia, whose hands were blown off in a civil war, back together. The 1967 graduate is now affiliated with Northwestern Memorial Hospital. He is now ranked highly amongst other surgeons in the Chicago area. The annual list was compiled by Castle Connolly Medical, described as a research and professionals in metropolitan Chicago, asking them to name the doctors they would recommend to a family member. Nagel says he is very happy he can hold this position on the list. His name is among 350 physicians and 55 specialties. A story of Nagel's great talent getting put to use is about a man getting his toe attached to his hand. Nagel attached a toe to just above the wrist area of one hand so the man could grasp everyday items. Nagel remembers the day very well when the man got to use his new hands. "He was the most grateful person I've ever seen," said Nagel. Caring for others is nothing new for Nagel, who grew up at Oogie's bussing tables and cooking food. His medical practice started turning its wheels back in 1984. Wanting to take his education farther, he studied at the University of Brussels, a medical school in Belgium. This education later brought him closer to home and an internship in Chicago, which led to his career today. Kevin Chalfant sang his way into the heart of the U.S., starting out from a little heart of Streator. Chalfant went through his share of bands throughout his life. His first national success was when he joined the AR Group 707 in 1982. They had a major hit that ranked number 12 on the Billboard's mainstream rock chart. That hit was Megaforce. Theme songs for movies had a calling to Chalfant. The theme song, "Hold On to the Vision," for the movie No Retreat, No Surrender, Kevin sang. Kevin is probably best known from his band, The Storm, which started in 1990, whom he was the lead singer of.
He not only sang, but he also wrote and co-wrote lyrics. I've Got a Lot to Learn About Love was one of Storm's hit songs that aired quite often in 1992 and 1993. The song made the top 40 in the Hot 100. He also won a BMI award for co-writing it. Kevin make a name for himself from what he had done up to that point. In 1994, Chalfant replaced Steve Perry temporarily from the band Journey. Chalfant then stuck to the Christian music by producing a Christmas CD in December of 2005. This album featured fans singing and caroling along with him. He then signed as a lead singer for Kansas AR group Shooting Star. Before leaving the band in 2006, he released one album titled Circles. In 2007, he released Fly Freedom, which is a 13-track solo album that covered his favorite Journey hits. Chalfant has had one adventure in life, switching from bands to solo albums, from movie theme songs to co-writing Billboard top hits. He has made himself into a huge success, representing Streator proudly.
In 1983, Streator Township High School welcomed a new student named Tony Obroda. As a freshman, Obroda was already interested in music. He began taking guitar lessons at the age of 12 from Don Howell, who owned the former Don's Music Supply in Streator. Obroda soon became the guitar player in high school for a band called Mixed Directions. His band, which included Ken Jackson and Don Watson, would play a wide variety of music, including country and rock, at many different places all around Streator. Some of these local venues included the Moose Lodge and the Elks Club. Obroda said in high school that he enjoyed learning new styles of music and playing for other people as much as he could. He credits Jackson and Watson with helping him develop a strong work ethic. In high school, Obroda said he definitely planned on making a career out of his music. Looking at him now, it is clear that Obroda definitely followed his dreams of being a professional guitar player. After graduating from Streator in 1987, he went on to college at Millikan University in Decatur. 2 weeks after graduating from there in 1991, he left for Nashville, Tennessee, also known as the Music City. Obroda has lived in this center for the music industry since then and has played guitar for many notable musicians such as Gretchen Wilson. He has also played for Suzu Bogas, Joe D. Messina, Winona Judd, The Wreckers, Leanne Rimes, and Little Big Town. Obroda said each of the artists he plays with allows him to spark his creativity.
They say life is so much sweeter through the telephoto lens of fame.
attention, cheering at the high school football game. I dreamed of going to Nashville, put my
After looking at some of Streator's greatest graduates, it is not hard to see they came a long way after taking that last walk down its hallways. The people they met and their experiences helped shape who they were after high school. Without the love and support they were given from their friends and family back home, their journeys would have been a lot harder. Streator proves to be the perfect environment for its students to prosper and grow. Whether it be a coach, mentor, teacher, or counselor, there were and still are many people at Streator to help out with students. With this in mind, only one question remains for today's Bulldogs. Are you next?
There's no city like my hometown, on that there's no debate. A hard-working, solid community since 1868. A place to live, to work and play, a city of renown. Streator, Streator, that's my hometown. Streator, Streator, that's my hometown. They came from the whole world over, with families by their side, to work the mines in hard scrabble and live with faith and pride. We're proud of the Bulldogs and Warriors, the finest kids around. In Streator, Streator, that's my hometown. Streator, Streator, that's my hometown. There's a lot to do in Streator and interesting things to see. Glass container, center of industry. Play golf and swim to keep in trim where parks and streams abound. Streator, Streator, that's my hometown. Streator, Streator, that's my hometown. I've traveled the whole world over and there's just one place for me. In the tall, tall corn of the Illinois plains, that's where I want to be. Raise my kids in the greatest place I've ever been.